So we have been looking at methods of solving ODE initial value problems, and under this category we have till now looked at Taylor series approximations. And in Taylor series approximations we said that the trouble with classical Taylor series is computation of partial derivatives. We don't want to explicitly compute partial derivatives. So is there a way out? And these Runge-Kutta methods actually provide a way out of this difficulty. You can do calculations equivalent to Taylor series approximation without having to explicitly compute derivatives. So you just do function evaluations, and the function evaluations are done in such a way that it is equivalent to doing Taylor series approximations. So we looked at last time this second order Runge-Kutta methods. And then I talked about a general Runge-Kutta method, second order Runge-Kutta method. So so the classical Taylor series approximation based method would actually have this formula, where I would have to compute the first derivative of f with respect to x and t. So this is the classical second order method, and Runge-Kutta method tries to do the same, achieve the same calculations without actually having to compute. So we have this Runge-Kutta method, xn plus 1 is equal to a generic formula I had written was xn plus h a k1 plus b k2, and k1 was nothing but chosen as fn, and K2 was so this is my generic second order Runge-Kutta method. K1 and K2 are function evaluations at some intermediate points, and these are carried out in such a way that you match, or in spirit you are doing second order Taylor series expansion. Okay, so I choose a, b, alpha, beta in such a way that these calculations are equivalent to this formula, and then we derived this generic by equating the coefficients, doing Taylor series expansion of this and equating the coefficients, we came up with a generic formula which was So this was a generic second order Runge-Kutta method. Different choices of free parameter B would give rise to different second order methods. So this second order method is actually equivalent to doing this second order Taylor series expansion without having to actually compute these derivatives. Okay, so we have chosen function evaluation at intermediate point, one in the beginning of the interval and one at an intermediate point, in such a way that doing these function evaluations is equivalent to doing derivative calculations. So you can think of this as some way of doing derivative approximations using finite points and then rearranging. Okay, you can do derivative approximations using some finite points and then do a rearrangement to get a formula in which you do not have to explicitly compute explicitly derivatives. Now likewise, you know, and we derived some specific rules, a specific formula. We had different choices. We had a choice which was B is equal to half, and then that gives you B is equal to half gives you Yoon's modified rule. B is equal to 1. Choosing B is equal to 1 gives you modified Cauchy-Euler formula. And so on. So likewise here, my third derivative, if I want to approximate using third order Taylor series, then I will have one more term, and then this d3x by dt cube I can expand in terms of df by dx. I will get some complex formula here. I am not writing that right now, but I will just give an equivalent Runge-Kutta. I will give an equivalent Runge-Kutta here. So my equivalent Runge-Kutta here would be xn plus 1 is equal to xn plus h a k1 plus b k2 plus c k3. And k1 is equal to fn, k2 is f Okay, if I want to approximate a third order Taylor series method using an equivalent Runge-Kutta method, the way it is done is something like this. Now if you see here, you can actually make out a pattern. The k1 here is always at the initial point. Okay, the k1 which is calculated is used here while calculating k2, okay, and this is at some intermediate point between 0 to h. The k2 which is calculated here is used in calculating k3, okay, and the unknown parameters a, b, c, alpha, beta, gamma, delta Okay, there are 7 parameters to be picked up. Okay, these you can get by equating the coefficients. You do Taylor series expansion of this, you do a Taylor series expansion of this, okay, and then equate the coefficients of the terms there. When you equate the coefficients of the terms, you will get and typically an overdetermined set of equations. You will get number of equations less than the number of unknowns, and you can pick some equations or some variables arbitrarily, and then you can fix those arbitrary variables and come up with the remaining variables. What you will get is a set of methods which are called third order Runge-Kutta method. Okay, and logically you can go on writing fourth order, fifth order. Basically, when you want to derive these equations, you have to be very, very patient, do Taylor series expansions properly, and then equate the coefficients to get the equations. Okay, what you are doing is essentially doing something equivalent to Taylor expansion without having to compute derivatives. Okay, so this explains entire class of Runge-Kutta methods. I mean, you might keep wondering, how did you get those coefficients and why compute at intermediate points? What is the basis? The basis is that these methods actually try to mimic and Taylor series expansion of equivalent order. So a fourth order Taylor series would try to mimic a fourth order, fourth order Runge-Kutta will try to mimic accuracy of a fourth order Taylor series expansion. Okay, so that is the basis. And looking at this pattern, you can go on developing. If I ask you conceptually, can you write fifth order set of equations? You can. Okay, because K2 is used here. If you have to write for fourth order, K3 will be used, okay, and 2 more parameters will appear, okay, and then you will get those many equations by comparing the coefficients, and then you can solve them. So typically up to fourth or fifth order, you might find them coefficients listed. Normally we can work with fourth or fifth order, you don't have to go beyond that to get reasonably good accuracy if you choose your integration step size carefully. Okay, now what do you do when you go for multivariable equations? Actually, we don't do the derivations. These derivations we have done for the scalar case. Right now, f here is a scalar of one variable equation. We do all the derivations of finding out the coefficients only for the scalar case. Okay, and we simply use that when you go to the vector case. There are no separate derivations for vector case. Okay, so we just make a simplifying assumption that the same thing will hold, and when I have to work with for example, I want to now do dx by dt is equal to, now I'm writing this capital F x t, okay, x belongs to Rn and f is a n cross 1 function vector, right, dx by dt. This is the kind of equations now we actually want to solve. In most of the cases we have vector differential equations which are coupled, which we cannot separate into separate equations, and the real problem is this. Okay, now we don't derive coefficients separately for this, we just derive coefficients, Runge-Kutta coefficients, only for scalar case. Okay, I'll just write down the formula for the fourth order Runge-Kutta, which is using this vector calculations. So again, you will be able to recognize the pattern. And just to give you a feel of what is done, so this is fourth order as you could have guessed, a fourth order Runge-Kutta method will have k1, k2, k3, k4, four function evaluations, okay? And the first one, obviously, k1 is just fn evaluation at the initial point. K2 is f tn plus h by 2. And mind you, this is one way of formulating fourth order Runge-Kutta. There will be other ways of getting this alpha, beta, delta coefficients. And K4 is F okay. You can notice the pattern. K1 is used in calculating K2, K2 is used in calculating K3, K3 is used in calculating K4. Okay? So same pattern, and this is multivariate implementation of same Runge-Kutta method. The coefficients here A, B, C are, you can recognize the coefficients, 1/6, 1/3, 1/3, 1/6. Okay? And we can also see alpha, beta, gamma, delta. Okay, and then there are two more, 6 coefficients will come here, and they have been chosen by equating the Taylor series expansion of fourth order and matching the coefficients. It's tedious, but you can just match the coefficients and then choose some of the free parameters, you will get this fourth order Runge-Kutta method. So this is the foundation of Runge-Kutta methods, Taylor series expansions. Okay. There are some other variations of Runge-Kutta, for example, variable step size Runge-Kutta method. I will come to that a little later when we talk about step size selection. How do you choose H? This becomes a very important thing when you are solving ODE IVP. And at a later point, when I discuss choice of H, at that point, I will talk about a variant of this called as variable step size Runge-Kutta method. So, but for the time being, let's now move on to the next class of methods, which is predictor corrector methods. Okay. So this is all about Taylor series expansion and its variant, which is Runge-Kutta. There are also some variants of this, like if you can see this is an explicit method. Okay, the way it is organized. If you see here, it's an explicit method because all the intermediate points, so this fn can be calculated. Given fn, k2 can be calculated. Okay, even k2, k3 can be calculated. Given k3, k4 can be calculated. So there is no iterations involved here. Okay, that is very, very important. There are some modifications of this which involve semi-implicit, some iterative calculations. What I have presented here, mostly the popular methods of Runge-Kutta are explicit methods. Okay. The next class, that is polynomial interpolation based methods. Under this class, I am going to talk about two types of methods. One is multi-step methods or multi-step methods. These multi-step methods are also known as predictor corrector methods. Some of the popular algorithm under this class is Gears predictor corrector. See, you might have heard about Gears integration algorithm. this in some book or some research paper you may have come across Gears predictor character. So those Gears predictor character belongs to this class. The second method I want to see under this is orthogonal collocation. The orthogonal collocations method, which we have seen or which we have used for solving or discretizing boundary value problems or discretizing the partial differential equations, this method, this approach can also be used for solving ODE initial value problems, and we'll have a peek at that too. So we begin with multi-step methods or predictor corrector methods. Now, again, my development is not going to be for multivariate case. My development is going to be for the scalar case. It's easier to understand, okay? And typically we do the same thing even for multi-step methods. We don't derive coefficients separately for vector case. We just make derivations for the scalar case, and we use those coefficients in the vector case, okay? So same idea which was done for Runge-Kutta. Runge-Kutta is derived for the scalar case. We just use those coefficients, okay, for the vector case. So it's going to be the same case here. So for the derivation sake, I'm going to be bothered about dx by dt is equal to small fx t, where x belongs to Rn. Sorry, x belongs to R. It's a scalar variable. And we are at point xtn is equal to xn. We are at the point xtn is equal to xn, and then I want to integrate over t . So again I am going to solve the same problem, one small ODE initial value problem, starting from time point tn and going to time point tn plus 1. Now when you say multi-step, let me clarify why this word multi-step is being used. In Runge-Kutta methods, we were just worried about going from Tn to Tn plus h. Okay, all that we used was xn, and then values between xn and xn plus 1. We created some intermediate points, okay, and then we did evaluations at the intermediate points between Tn to Tn plus h, and then we did the calculations. Okay, here the philosophy is different. Here, what I am going to say is that, well, I have information available about what has happened in the past. Okay, see, I am currently at Tn. I want to go to Tn plus h. Okay, so my problem is I have xn here and I want to find out xn plus 1. I want to go from here to here, right? But I have started my integration somewhere here. This is my x0, okay, and then I have this information about Tn minus 1, Tn minus 2, Tn minus 3. Right? I have information about xn minus 1, xn minus 2, xn minus 3, because I have started integrating from time 0, okay, and I have this information. When I have reached up to point Tn, I have information in the past. Okay, I want to march from Tn to Tn plus 1 step ahead in future. Currently I am at Tn. Okay, I have this past information. Apart from this, I also have not only information of x at these discrete time points, I also have information about f n minus 1. I also have information about f n minus 2. Right? These are values in the past. I can evaluate the derivatives at the point in the past. Okay? I can evaluate, I know the values of the x, or I know the value of the solution at time points in the past. Okay. What I'm going to do is, when I go from here to here, okay, I'm going to make use of this past information. Okay, I'm going to see. It's like again, if you take the analogy of you know, when you are climbing down a mountain, okay, when you take the next step, you may want to use information about what has happened in the past. Okay, how was the slope and what is the local curvature? You want to use that information and make one step ahead. Okay, the Runge-Kutta method only, you know, looks at it. Everything that is in the past is contained in xn, and I just want to go from xn to xn plus 1. So Runge-Kutta method, when it goes ahead, it is cautious. It takes small steps in between and goes. Okay, here, whereas here we are not going to do intermediate calculations. Okay, we are going to use calculations at these previous time points to make a judgment about how to go in the past. So the one major difference here is that these are fixed step size methods. So Tn, or in general Ti minus Ti minus 1 is h. So the step size is fixed. Okay. Now what is the philosophy? Philosophy is to use an interpolation polynomial. What is an interpolation polynomial? Interpolation polynomial is one which passes through a given set of fixed points. Okay, so one idea is that if I have this xn minus 1, xn minus 2, xn minus 3, okay, I can invoke Weierstrass theorem and say that well, my solution x is actually a continuous function. Okay, a continuous function can be approximated by a polynomial. What kind of polynomial? I am going to fit an interpolation polynomial. So I am going to fit a polynomial using this data. Okay, I am going to fit a polynomial using this data and do an extrapolation. Okay, I fit a polynomial using past data and extrapolate from Tn to Tn plus 1. Okay, other idea is so this will give me an explicit method. The other idea is I try to fit a polynomial using xn plus 1, xn. So using future and the past, okay, then you get implicit formula, because you will get the future is a function of, you know, this xn plus 1 is a function of xn, xn plus 1 is a function of xn plus 1, and you have to solve iteratively. Okay, so basically I'm going to fit a polynomial. I'm going to fit a polynomial. So my idea is to fit a polynomial. So I'm going to say that xt is now my notation is little bit complex, okay, and you have to carefully understand my notation. Let's say I want to fit a cubic polynomial, okay, or I want to fit a let's take the simplest polynomial, quadratic polynomial. Okay, I want to fit a quadratic polynomial. So x0n plus x1n t plus x okay, this is a polynomial, this is a polynomial solution. Let's call this local solution xnt. Okay, let's call this solution xnt. What is this n? Okay, this n corresponds to the point Tn. I am standing at Tn. Okay. I am not going to fit one polynomial. Okay. At this point, I am going to fit a polynomial locally, a quadratic polynomial. Okay. And use it to do extrapolation. When I move on, Okay, I am going to fit another polynomial. I am not happy with fitting one polynomial. It's not possible to fit one giant polynomial into all. Suppose you are integrating from 0 to time 1000 minutes and your integration interval is 10 seconds. Okay, I cannot fit an interpolation polynomial of high order. Okay, I cannot fit one quadratic polynomial because the nature is changing as you move along. The slope is changing. So I want to fit a local polynomial using local neighborhood data. Okay, and then do an extrapolation. Okay, so we are just going to use the local information, and these polynomial coefficients are going to be time varying. They are going to change as you move in time. Okay, that's why this index, subindex n comes. Okay, now 0, 1, 2 is a quadratic polynomial which I want to fit locally. Okay, this is fit in the sense I am not going to do least square fit here, I am going to do interpolation polynomial. Okay, let's see how we can fit this local interpolation polynomial. Okay, now what I can do is I can differentiate this polynomial. Okay, what will I get if I differentiate the polynomial? A1n plus 2a2n t. Okay, 2a2n t. Now I am going to temporarily shift the time, okay, such that I am going to shift my time axis such that Tn corresponds to 0. Okay, for making this local fit, I am going to shift the time axis such that Tn corresponds to 0. So what will be Tn plus 1? This will be h. What will be Tn minus 1? This will be minus h. What will be Tn minus 2? Minus 2h, and so on. Okay. Now, when I am fitting a polynomial, in this case I am fitting a quadratic polynomial or quadratic interpolation polynomial, how many coefficients are there? There are three coefficients, a0, a1, a2. Okay. How many equations I need to exactly determine the three? I need three equations. So somehow I have to generate three equations. Okay, somehow I have to generate three equations. So let us start doing this by, with this shifted time scale, okay, with this shifted time scale, I am going to now generate three equations in three unknowns, and once I have solution of three equations in three unknowns, I have one way of doing calculations. Okay, so now let's see how this is done. Okay, so what is x0 at t is equal to tn? We have shifted time now. Okay, in shifted time, what will be x0 will correspond to xn. Okay, now xn in terms of shifted time, this will be a0n. Okay, plus a1n into 0 plus a2n into 0. Okay, I got the first coefficient. What is my first coefficient? Because this is 0, so this is 0, this is 0, I got x0n is equal to xn. Okay, now I need to generate two more equations. Okay, see, dx by dt is nothing but f of x, right? Now what is fn? That is function evaluated at time tn. Okay, that will be equal to a 1n, a1n, okay, plus 2a2n into 0. Fine? So this is 0 because with shifted time, this is 0. Okay, so I got second coefficient. A1n is equal to fn. Okay, now I want to generate the third equation. How do I generate the third equation? I can use the past. Okay, I can use information at xn minus 1, or I could use information of fn minus 1. I have a choice. I can choose from xn minus 1 or fn minus 1. Okay, so which one do you want to go? Xn minus 1? Okay, we'll do derive both ways. Okay, we'll derive both ways. So let's take initially the possibility that to fit the interpolation polynomial, I'm going to use xn minus 1. Okay, so what will be xn minus 1? Xn minus 1 will be a0 n plus minus, yeah, so a1 n into minus h plus a2 n h square, right? A2 n h square. Okay, now can you eliminate and find out a2n? Just tell me what is a2n. Because a0n is nothing but xn. We got this a0n is equal to xn. We got a1n is nothing but fn. So these two coefficients are known to us. Okay, these two coefficients are known to us. Okay, what is the third coefficient? So what I'll get if I just substitute there, I know that a0n is equal to xn. I have found that a1n is equal to fn, right? Now the third equation that I got is xn minus 1 is equal to xn minus fn into h, right, plus a2n h square. So what is a2n h square? So a2n will be xn minus 1 minus xn plus h fn divided by h square. Okay, this is my interpolation polynomial. This is my coefficients of interpolation polynomial. So I have found out a interpolation polynomial with time varying coefficients. So what is my interpolation polynomial? Let's go back and write it here. So my interpolation polynomial is now, let's write it in terms of the shifted time. Let's call it tau, shifted time. Okay, this is equal to, what is a0n is xn, okay, is xn plus, what is the second coefficient? Second coefficient is fn into tau. Tau is the shifted time. Tau is the shifted time. Okay. And what is the third coefficient? Xn minus 1 minus xn plus h fn divided by h square into t square, tau square. right? Is everyone with me on this? See, I fitted an interpolation polynomial. There are three coefficients, a0n. a0n turns out to be xn, okay? a1n turns out to be fn, okay? And a2n turns out to be xn minus 1 minus xn plus hfn by h square into tau square. This is my polynomial, okay? This is the polynomial, second order polynomial, fitted using this point and this point in the past. Okay, now I am going to do extrapolation. How will you do extrapolation? What I want to find out? The next step. So how will you get the next step? Tau is equal to h. Okay, tau is equal to h will give me this point. So what will I get if I substitute tau is equal to h here? Just substitute, no? If you substitute tau is equal to h, you will get xn plus 1. See, setting tau is equal to h will give you xn plus 1. Okay? So if I set tau is equal to h, that is, I want to go to this point, then if I substitute that here, tau is equal to h, I will get xh. Xh is nothing but xn plus 1. Okay, xn plus 1 is equal to xn into fn into h. Okay, fn into h plus here you will get h square. So this h square will cancel. Okay, can you rearrange and write? What do you get now? Yeah, so what do you get? So after rearranging, you will get xn minus 1 plus 2 h fn. Is that right? Okay. The final formula looks like this. The final formula, you don't see the interpolation polynomial anywhere. Okay. The interpolation polynomial which you have fitted locally has disappeared in this final form. Actually, what you have done is fitted a local polynomial. Is this the only way of doing this? No. Okay, let's do it some other way. Okay. What is this formula which you got? Is this an explicit formula or implicit formula? This is an explicit formula. Okay. Because anything that is before is known to you. Okay. What is in the future is not known to you. Let's make a small modification and see what you get now. If you, this point, I have chosen xn minus 1. I have chosen xn minus 1. Instead of that, let's choose here. Let's go back here. Okay. Make a small modification. And I will choose xn plus 1. Just derive what will happen. If I choose xn plus 1, this will be a0n. This will be a1n. And this will be plus h. Minus h will disappear. And this will be h square. What will you get? Okay, my equation here, this a0n is still xn, a1n is still fn. Okay, this equation will change. This will be xn plus 1 is equal to xn plus h fn, and this will be minus, this will be xn plus 1. Minus hfn. Okay, divided by h square. That is your a2n now. Okay, this has become xn plus 1 instead of xn minus 1. This is xn plus 1, xn, hfn. Okay, now what? How will the formula be modified? Just go back and derive the formula now. What do you get? You will still end up with an explicit formula, I think. So what is the polynomial that you are fitting now? You will get x tau is equal to xn plus fn tau plus what is the third coefficient? Xn plus 1 minus xn plus h fn by h square tau square. Okay. Now what do you get? You'll get 0 equal to 0 here? Oh great. So we'll have to, this will not help us. So what way to go? What about f? Fn plus 1. Can you use fn plus 1? Just check. Now instead of using xn plus 1, I decide to use fn plus 1. Okay? So here you get 0 equal to 0. So xn plus 1 is not useful. So we need fn plus 1. What is fn plus 1? Fn plus 1 will be a1n plus 2a2n into plus h. Plus h. Okay? Now using this, I will get these two coefficients remain same. I will get 2a2n is equal to, or fn plus 1 is equal to fn plus 2a2nh. So what is a2nh? a2n is equal to fn plus 1 minus fn divided by 2h. By 2h. If you substitute this, what will you get? So my formula now becomes here. This becomes, so this is my time varying polynomial. This is fn plus 1 minus fn divided by 2h square or 2h into tau square. Okay? 2h tau square. So if I set h is equal to tau, so I will get xn plus 1. What is the integration formula? Xn plus 1 is equal to xn plus h by 2 f of n plus f of the famous trapezoidal rule. Okay? This is an implicit formula because xn plus 1 appears on the left hand side, xn plus 1 appears on the right hand side. Okay? This is our famous trapezoidal rule. I got an implicit formula. Okay? So when you see it in this form, you don't see the interpolation polynomial. Okay, and what I want to stress here, it's matter of choice, how do you choose which point to fit? See, suppose I give you a problem in which you have to fit a cubic polynomial. What will you do? Cubic polynomial will have four coefficients. You need four equations. How will you generate four equations? There are a variety of ways. You could do using xn, xn minus 1, xn minus 2, xn minus 3. Okay, you could do using fn, fn minus 1, xn, xn minus 1, four equations. Okay, you could do using, you know, this and this. Okay, which points you use, all of them are called multi-step methods. Okay, so I'll just summarize this here. Yeah, you have a doubt?
I mean, you know only xn.
No. It only give you problem at the time zero. No, no, no. At time zero, you have to make some assumption about past. Yeah. Why you start with the wrong guess? You start with the same initial point, multiple same point in the beginning, and then start creating new points. Only first 3 points will be problem. 3 or 4 points. After that, you have the past, right? No, there is nothing like a wrong guess. No, I am not. This is not iterative solutions. See, when you are solving ordinary differential equations, you are not guessing. You are marching in time. Okay. So, do you know some values in the past? Is the question. Okay. So it's not just one initial condition, you know, you need to know some values in the past.
You can only one value in the past, sir, and assume some other value.
No, I can assume the same value was there in the past. The system was at the same point in the beginning for last 4 instances. If I make that assumption, there is nothing wrong. And I can go on marching. So after 3 instances, I will have past 3, and then I can go on doing it. It doesn't create a problem. So the convergence to the true solution depends upon something else. Okay, so it doesn't matter even if you have slightly wrong initial 3 or 4 points. Okay, so basically, if I want to fit a polynomial of the form, xn t is equal to a naught n plus a1 n t plus a2 n t square plus a3 n t cube. Okay, I want to find out a naught, a1, a2, a3. Okay, to generate this, either I can use xn minus 1, xn minus 2, xn minus 3. I could use xn fn, xn minus 1, fn minus 1. I could use xn fn f1 plus 1 fn minus 1. I want to create 4 equations in 4 unknowns, fit an interpolation polynomial, okay, of cubic type with time varying coefficients. Those time varying coefficients can be either function of past 3 x values, they can be 2 derivative 2 x values, it can be 3 derivatives, 1 x value, it's up to you. Okay. So every possible combination will give rise to one multi-step method. Okay. Will give rise to multi-step method. Final form, the quadratic, the cubic polynomial or whatever, that cubic form will disappear. You will only see an integration method with some coefficients. Okay. What I'll do in my next class is derive a generic mth order polynomial to be fitted in. Okay, I'll derive a method, formula for mth order method, and so we can do any order fitting. Okay, find a multi-step method and derive it. So you should understand what is the philosophy. You should be able to derive a new method if you want. That is very, very important. That's what I wanted to learn from this exercise. Because the final rearranged form, the origin disappears. It looks like some recipe, you take this, do this, you'll get the solution. What is the philosophy is not clear when you look at, in the next lecture, we'll continue this multi-step methods. I'll try to finish multi-step method. There are different classes of multi-step methods. One which only use past F, one which use only past X, and so on. And then there are variations. You get explicit methods, you get implicit methods. Then you use explicit method to initialize an implicit method. The same idea which we use for Euler, that is, how do you get a good guess? Okay, so you get a good guess by Euler and then, kick off your iterations. And that, the same thing you do here, you take an nth order multi-step method, explicit, and use it to initialize an nth order implicit method. And that way, you can converge faster. So a large number of methods exist because the way you fit the polynomial is up to you. How much information in the past you want to consider relevant, it's up to you. Okay, so order you can choose, how much data you want to choose in the past you can choose. And then you can go on marching using interpolating polynomials. Okay, what is important to remember, there is no one interpolating polynomial. It's like series of interpolating polynomials. Every time you move on, you are fitting a new interpolation polynomial. You move on, you fit a new interpolation polynomial. Okay, so sequence of interpolation polynomials. That is very, very important.